بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our eighth lesson going through the book أخلاق وحملة القرآن authored by الأجري رحمه الله. We stopped at a statement of the author, باب أخلاق المقري إذا جلس يقرئ ويلقن لله تعالى ماذا ينبغي له أن يتخلق به. So in this lesson, we're going to talk about the etiquettes of the teacher who's going to sit and teach the people the Quran. What are the etiquettes that he's supposed to come with? What are the specific etiquettes that the teacher is supposed to come with? How is the teacher supposed to conduct himself in teaching the Quran? And the next lesson we'll talk about the opposite, i.e. the student. How does the student conduct himself with his teacher? And so basically these next two lessons talk about the teacher-student relationship. Now, قال المصنف رحمه الله ينبغي لمن علمه الله كتابه فأحب أن يجلس في المسجد يقرأ القرآن لله يغتنم قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. So it's imperative upon the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught you the Quran, and you wish to sit in the masjid and teach the people the Quran, or whether it be the masjid where the Quran is being taught, or in a madrasa, madaris or tahfidh مثلا, the places where that have been set up as places to memorize the Quran. You want to sit there and you want to teach, and you're doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, notice that you are taking advantage of the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. So when a person has his intent to teach people the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that he's taking advantage of this hadith, that he's becoming the best of the people. خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. We know the famous example of Abu Abd al-Rahman al-Sulami rahmatullah alayh, who when he heard this hadith, he began to what? Sit in the masjid in Kufa and teach the people the Quran. And that's what he became known for, teaching the people the Quran, in order for him to take advantage of this great hadith and to act upon it. Nah. فَيَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَسْتَعْمِلَ مِنَ الْأَخْلَاقِ الشَّرِيفَةِ مَا يَدُلُّ عَلَى فَضْلِهِ وَصِدْقِهِ. And so it's imperative upon this person who is going to sit and teach people the Quran al-Kareem, and he's doing it for the sake of Allah, that he adorns himself with these good manners. Manners that show off your virtue, show off your honesty, right? Your sincerity, right? In the cause that you are undertaking, and that is to teach people the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first etiquette, وَهُوَ أَنْ يَتَوَاضَعَ فِي نَفْسِهِ إِذَا جَلَسَ فِي مَجْلِسِهِ. When you sit in your gathering, when you sit in the place in which you're going to be teaching the Quran, in your place of teaching, that you humble yourself. Humble yourself. مَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ. The one who humbled himself for Allah, Allah will raise him. نعم. وَلَا يَتَعَاظَمَ فِي نَفْسِهِ. You shouldn't become self-amazed or make yourself feel high and mighty. لا. Rather, you have to be humble. أحب أن يستقبل القبلة في مجلسه لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أفضل المجالس ما استقبل به القبلة. So here he mentions that what he would love for the teacher to have also is when he is teaching the Quran to sit facing the قبلة. And he bases on a hadith which is weak. أفضل المجالس ما استقبل به القبلة. The best sittings or the best gatherings are the gatherings that you face the قبلة. So you face the direction of the قبلة. ويعني هذا حديث فيه ضعف. ويتواضع لمن يلقنه القرآن. So the teacher has to exercise humility, humble yourself to the student whom you are teaching the Quran. ويقبل عليه إقبالا جميلا. And likewise turn to your student a beautiful turning, meaning give your attention to the student. Don't be preoccupied with something else whilst the student is reciting the Quran, because the student wants engagement. Students, they want engagement and they want to be engaged with their teacher. طيب. And when you have that back and forth and you have that engagement on both sides, it makes the process of learning the Quran far more smoother. وينبغي له أن يستعمل مع كل إنسان يلقنه ما يصلح لمثله. And another important etiquette is that every student will be different from one another. Each student is different. No two students will be the same. And so the way in which you treat one student has to be in accordance to what that person needs. Right? So you have to analyze a student, see what level he is at, and give him the required form of teaching that will allow him to rise up in level and become better in reciting the Quran. طيب. So يلقنه ما يصلح لمثله. Right? ما يصلح لمثله. So whatever is suitable for him and people of his type. طيب. So you don't teach the elder student the way that you teach the younger student. You don't use the same technique with the one who's a half of the Quran and he's just reciting the Quran for you to get ijazah, compared to the one who is what? Starting to learn the Quran. You have to teach using different techniques, and so the teacher has to be flexible. Nah. إذا كان يتلقن عليه الصغير والكبير والحدث. Right? Of course, when you are a teacher, you're going to have young students, you're going to have older students, you're going to have teenage students. طيب. الحدث refers to those who have just past age of puberty, or in and around the region of puberty. And so it's important that the teacher is flexible in this regard. والغني والفقير. Likewise, you have a rich student and you have a poor student. And these two individuals come from totally different backgrounds, totally different ways of life. And so you have to incorporate that when you're teaching them. Of course, while still maintaining justice. What is justice? Justice is to put everything in its right place, right? There's a difference between equality and justice. Justice is to put everything in its right place. And so when you put things in the right place with the rich student, and when you put things in place in the right place with the poor student, the actual action won't be the same. So the way that you do it with the rich and the way that you do it with the poor student is not going to be the same. The way that you do it with the younger one and the old one is not going to be the same. But in the end, what happens is what? Justice, and everybody is able to rise up and become bi-idhnillahi ta'ala hamalatun likitabillah, carriers of the Quran al-Kareem, which is the eventual goal that we want from these individuals that we are teaching the Quran to, and that we are passing the Quran down to that next generation. Naam. فَيَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَن يُوَفِّي كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهُ. And this is the essence of justice, to give everyone their right, to put everything in its right place. وَأَعْتَقِدَ الْإِنصَافَ إِن كَانَ يُرِيدُ اللَّهَ بِتَلْقِينِهِ الْقُرْآنِ فَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَن يُقَرِّبَ الْغَنِيَّ وَيُبْعِدَ الْفَقِيرِ. And so you have to be what? Munsif, right? At the same time. So whilst you come with justice, you don't come with what? Ghulm, right? So مثلا, because it's one, we spoke about it in the previous lesson, right? Those people who, when the faqir is brought to teach them the Quran, they are what? Extremely harsh, and they don't give them their right. But when it's the rich one, they want to what? Give them more than their right. طيب? And so they focus on them much more. And the reason why they do that is because of a dunya that this person has, which you are searching for. Naam, so we have to avoid that. طيب. وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَرْفُقَ بِالْغَنِيِّ وَيَحْذِقَ بِالْفَقِيرِ فَإِنْ فَعَلَ هَذَا فَقَدْ جَارَ فِي فِعْلِهِ. So you shouldn't be soft with the rich one and harsh with the poor one. Right? And the only reason why you're doing that is because the rich one has it. Either power or status, nobility, right? You don't want to get into trouble, or he has dunya that you want from, whereas the faqir doesn't have that protection, or he doesn't have that dunya that you want, right? And so you become a walim, you become a ja'ir, you become an oppressor. We don't want that. Now, we spoke about that in the previous lesson. فَحُكْمُهُ أَنْ يَعْدِلَ بَيْنَهُمَا. You have to be just between them. Naam. And so not أَنْ يُسَاوِي بَيْنَهُمَا, بَلْ يَعْدِلُ بَيْنَهُمَا. So there's a difference between equality and justice. Naam. ثم ينبغي له أن يحذر على نفسه التواضع للغني والتكبر على الفقير. Likewise, you should avoid, again, this is another issue which is secondary to what we mentioned previously. You can't be arrogant towards the faqir and humble towards the rich. لا, you have to be, in this regard, just. طيب. No one's saying treat the غني with the exact same manner, meaning as you would the faqir. لا. Or treat the faqir in the exact same manner as the ghani. Sometimes you might have to treat the faqir with more leniency, and the ghani with a bit more strictness. And it's of course from min bab al-adl, min bab al-adl. Eventually you want both of them to rise. طيب. However, you can't come and show ظلم to each one. طيب. Of course you can't treat them equally in everything. لا. Because treating them equally in everything might mean actually ظلم might come out from it. Rather, what's expected is al-adl, to be just between them. طيب. And the way that you achieve that justice, of course, will vary from one person to another. But the goal is to achieve justice, طيب, for both sets of students, whether it be the poor student or the rich student. طيب. مثلا, the rich one, he might be able to pay more money. And so he pays a bit more than the poor one, right? The poor one may not be able to pay the fee that maybe the school requires. And so you are lenient with him on that. Whereas the rich one, you may not be necessarily as lenient. And this is, of course, to achieve overall justice. طيب. مقربا لمجلسه متعطفا عليه as the author رحمه الله mentioned, بل يكون متواضعا للفقير مقربا لمجلسه متعطفا عليه يتحبب الى الله بذلك. And so when it comes to the faqir, one of the roads, one of the ways that you interact with him is through leniency and through bringing him closer to you, right? Because the faqir generally might have problems at home. He may not have had food, he may not have had drink. طيب. He has other humum, he has other problems which the rich one may not necessarily have, and so you have to make things easier for him. And this is, of course, a manner to achieve the justice that we are required to come. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو بكر بن أبي داود قال حدثنا إسحاق بن الجراح الأذني ومحمد بن عبد الملك قال لنا نبأنا جعفر بن عون قال أنبأنا أبو جعفر الرازي عن الربيع بن أنس في قوله تعالى ولا تصعر خدك للناس. قال يكون الغني والفقير عندك في العلم سواء. So when you have the knowledge, or sorry, when you have the, so you have the explanation of Qulla Ta'ala, ولا تصعر خدك للناس. Right, the companion here is saying that يكون الغني والفقير عندك سواء في العلم. So when it comes to your giving of knowledge, it has to be when it's the poor and the rich, the same. So you don't hide knowledge, or you don't deprive knowledge from the poor and give it to the rich, or you don't deprive knowledge from the rich and give it to the poor. Rather, everyone, the door should be open to everybody who wants to learn. طيب, that's what this is being mentioned by. Some people, they want to teach only to the rich, so they exclusively teach to the rich and they don't really teach to the poor. And then you have some who want to exclude the poor, the rich completely, and just teach to the poor. طيب, rather a person should have an open door policy, of course, on the condition that the person actually wants to learn. Now, then the author, rahimahullah, he said, حدثنا ابن أبي داود قال حدثنا بشر بن خالد العسكري قال حدثنا شبابة يعني ابن السوار عن أبي جعفر الرازي عن الربيع بن أنس عن أبي العالية في قوله ولا تصعر خدك للناس قال يكون الغني والفقير عندك في العلم سواء. بتونس عليها. قال محمد بن حسين إلى جري ويتناول فيه ما أدب الله به نبيه حيث أمره أن يقرب الفقير ولا تعد عيناك عنهم إذا كان قوم أرادوا الدنيا فأحبوا أو فأحبوا من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يدني منهم مجلسهم. And so here the author is linking it back to the action of the Prophet ﷺ. The Messenger of Allah was commanded to bring the poor one closer. Remember when the Messenger of Allah was talking to the Sada of Quraysh, right? And the blind man came to him, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, and the Messenger of Allah turned away from him, right? عاتبه الله تعالى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إلى آخره. طيب, and likewise here, ولا تعد عيناك عنهم تريد زينة الحياة الدنيا ولا تطع من أغفلنا قلبه عن ذكرنا واتبع هواه وكان أمره فرضا واصبر نفسك مع الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي ولا تطرد الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه رأيت ما عليك من حسابهم من شيء ومن حسابك عليهم من شيء فتطردهم فتكون من الخاسرين something like that. نعم. طيب, and so here we see in these ayat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching the Prophet to not turn away from the poor, rather to bring them closer to you, especially those poor who want to seek knowledge and want to yani learn the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the state of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فكيف بناء. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله فأحب من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يدني منهم مجلسهم ويرفعهم على من سواهم من الفقراء. فأجابهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى ما سألوا, لا لأنه أراد الدنيا ولكنه تألفهم على الإسلام. فأرشد الله نبيه على أشرف الأخلاق عنده فأمره أن يقرب الفقراء وينبسط إليهم ويصبر عليهم وأن يباعد الأغنياء الذين يميلون إلى الدنيا. فعل صلى الله عليه وسلم, وهذا أصل يحتاج إليه جميع من جلس يعلم القرآن والعلم ويتأدب به ويلزم نفسه ذلك إن كان يريد الله بذلك. طيب, and so here the messenger of Allah when he was initially talking to the rich who had their hearts attached to the dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he commanded him to bring the poor people closer to you. And you find it in the hadith of Abi Sufyan, right? When Hiraql asked him who follows the messenger, he said, ضعفاء الناس فقراءهم وضعفاءهم كما قال, right? أشراف الناس تبعوه أم ضعفاءهم قال بل ضعفاءهم, right? And so it's the weak ones who follow the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. طيب, and so يعني it's imperative for the person who's teaching the Quran that he brings the poor ones closer, those who are less well off, those who are less in terms of يعني rank and status and nobility and so on, right? And that is to grow them, to cultivate them, and it's something which يعني you find throughout civilizations. Empires are generally built upon the weak. طيب, you look at مثلا the Ottomans, the Mamluks, right? The Mamalik, they were slaves, right? They were the weakest, right? Many of the civilizations that we see today, they were built upon the actions of the weak ones and cultivating them, right? So you had a group of elites and you had a group of the weak, طيب, and you cultivate the weak and you make them strong, and they grow up to be strong warriors and strong people of excellent minds, and they are able to then bring forth a new empire or a new age. طيب, And you find, many of the celebrities today, or many of the most richest people in the world today, when you look at their biographies and you look at some of the most successful people on earth today, when you look at their biographies, they were poor people, right? They were poor people, right? They didn't grow up with a lot. But however, because of that desire, because of that determination that they have to make something of themselves, these are excellent vessels for you to instill in them Hubbul Quran, Hubbul Sunnah, Hubbul Ilm. Now, so they grow up to be carriers of this amana. Then the author rahimahullah, he says, وهذا أصل يحتاج إليه جميع من جلس يعلم القرآن والعلم ويتأدب به ويلزم نفسه ذلك إن كان يريد الله بذلك. وأنا أذكر ما فيه ليكون الناظر في كتابنا هذا فقيها فيما يتقرب إلى الله به يقرأ لله ويقضي ثوابه من الله لا من المخلوقين. So he's going to mention to us some of the etiquettes that the طالب, that the student, that the معلم, I should say, that the teacher should have knowledge of, so that he can become well versed in knowing what I need to do in order to be a competent teacher that is doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then allow me to become a person who can enter or can be amongst those whom the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant when he said خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو القاسم عبد الله بن محمد بن عبد العزيز قال حدثنا أحمد بن محمد بن يحيى بن سعيد القطان أبو القاسم عبد الله بن محمد بن عبد العزيز البغوي صاحب الجعديات قال حدثنا أحمد بن محمد بن يحيى بن سعيد القطان قال حدثنا عمرو بن محمد العنقري قال حدثنا أسباط عن السدي عن أبي سعد الأزدي وكان قارئ الأزدي عن أبي الكنودي عن خباب بن الأرت في قول الله تعالى ولا تطرد الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه إلى قوله فتكون من الظالمين. Right, and so the ayat ولا تطرد الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه ما عليك من حسابهم من شيء ومن حسابك عليهم من شيء فتطردهم فتكون من الظالمين. نعم. قال جاء الأقرع بن حابس التميمي وعينة بن حصن الفزاري. So this author is Munkar actually, by the way. Right, and the reason why it's Munkar is because Al-Aqra' ibn Habis and Uyaynah ibn Hisn, they accepted Islam after Fath Makkah, whereas these ayat were revealed way back in the early period of Islam. Surah Al-An'am is Surah Al-Makkiyah, right? And so the tafsir or the story behind this, the story that's mentioned in this athar, which is essentially discussing a reason for the revelation of these ayat, some may say that this reason doesn't really stand because these ayat were revealed far earlier. No, than the actual incident that took place. طيب. Because Al-Aqra' ibn Habis and Uyaynah ibn Hisn accepted Islam way late. طيب. So they came. فَوَجْدَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَعَ صُهَيْبٍ وَبِلَالٍ وَعَمَّارٍ. And so they found the Messenger of Allah with three of his companions, Suhayb, Bilal, and Ammar. Three poor ones. Right? Suhayb al-Rumi, Bilal al-Habashi, and Ammar ibn Yasir was مولى بني مخزوم من Yemen. He's from Yemen. His parents are from Yemen. Right? His father's from Yemen. His mother was a Habashiya. Right? Sumayya. She was Mawla for the Makhzumi tribe. And Yasir, he came from Mecca, and he became a ally to Bani Makhzum, and he married off, and he was married to Sumayya. Sumayya bint Khayyat, therefore they are the two first martyrs in Islam. The first martyr in Islam was Sumayya, then Yasir. Right? And the Messenger of Allah, he said, that indeed they are their end will be in paradise, فَإِنَّ مَعِدَكُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. اصبروا على ياسر فإن وعدكم الجنة. They were tortured in Mecca. نعم. رضوان الله عليهم أجمعين. And so صهيب بلال عمار الخباب. نعم. So صهيب بلال عمار الخباب. خباب was also a blacksmith, right? He was a poor one as well. رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. And so these four companions, مهاجرين, شهد المشاهد مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. You know the famous story of صهيب الرومي when he was going to the Hijrah, right? That we spoke about in our Sira classes. نعم. قاعدا في أناس من الضعفاء من المؤمنين. And so they found the Messenger of Allah. So Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, remember, and Uyaynah ibn Hisn, they are Asiyad, they are Sadah, they are masters of the people. Right? Uyaynah ibn Hisn al-Fazari and Al-Aqra' ibn Habis al-Tamimi, they are the chieftains of their tribes. طيب. And so they're coming and they're seeing the Messenger of Allah, Sayyidu Waladi Adam, sitting with these poor individuals, right? Sitting with a black man, sitting with a Roman, sitting with a Yemeni, right? And sitting with Khabbab ibn al-Arat. Right, so he's sitting with these individuals, even ضعفاء الناس, right? فقال, and so they said, الأقرأ عن عيينة, they said, إنا نريد أن تجعل لنا منك مجلسا تعرف لنا به العرب. So, O Messenger of Allah, we want you to give us a gathering, a sitting that the Arabs will know us by, meaning we don't want to sit with these poor ones, we want to sit with you in a meeting where we're sitting with the Sada, we're sitting with the noble ones, we're sitting in a private gathering, a gathering where only the elites are allowed, not these peasants, right, that they saw them to be, like Khabbab and Suhaib and Ammar and Bilal and so on. So they said, إِنَّا نُرِيدُ أَن تَجْعَلَ لَنَا مِنْكَ مَجْلِسًا تَعْرِفُ لَنَا بِهِ الْعَرَبُ نَأْتِيكَ فَنَسْتَحِي أَن تَرَانَ الْعَرَبُ مَعَ هَذِهِ الْأَعْبُدُ. For indeed we are shy from being seen by the Arabs, us sitting with these slaves, or sitting with these peasants. فَإِذَا نَحْنُ جِئْنَاكَ فَنَحِّهِمْ عَنَّا. So when we come to you, remove these individuals from us. If we want to sit with you and have a conversation with you, and the Arabs are proud of our meeting. Oh, look at this, Ibn Abd al-Muttalib and the Abna of Tamim and the Abna of Bani Fazara, the Sada, are sitting together having a fantastic meeting. We don't want that meeting to be tainted with the presence of these peasants. That's what they are trying to say. فإذا نحن فرغنا فقعد معهم. And so when we finish and we leave, you can then go back and sit with them however well you want. فقال نعم أي فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم okay. And of course the hadith is munkar, by the way. This athar is munkar. طيب لا يثبت. However, we're just reciting it so we can maybe glean some benefits from it in terms of the actual etiquette that the author wants to extract from it, which is basically the affirmation of what he mentioned earlier, which is that the messenger of Allah or the qari, sorry, or the teacher should be sitting with the poor ones and bringing them closer and not removing them for the sake of the rich ones. نعم. Or for the sake of yielding to the demands of the rich ones. نعم. فقال فاكتب لنا عليك كتابا قال فدعا بالصحيفة ودعا عليا ليكتب ونحن قعود في ناحية. And so they said, write for us a book or a letter. And the messenger of Allah asked for paper to be brought, يعني a صحيفة to be brought. And he ordered Ali to write. Remember the messenger of Allah, he was أمي الذين تابعون رسول النبي الأمي illiterate. نعم. ليكتب ونحن قعود في ناحية. And we're sitting in a specific region, in the place, in the gathering. فنزل جبريل. Jibreel descended. فقال, and he recited what he learned from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the ayah, وَلَا تَطْرُدِ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَا مَا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ حِسَابِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وَمِنْ حِسَابِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَتَطْرُدَهُمْ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Right, and then the next ayah, ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الْأَقْرَعَ وَعُيَيْنَا. So the first ayah, وَلَا تَطْرُدِ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ, this is concerning who? خَبَّاب and بِلَال and عَمَّار and صُهَيْب. They are the ones who call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day and the night. طيب, and so the Messenger of Allah is being told to not chuck them away or not cast them away. And then Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ فَتَنَّا بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ, referring to الْأَقْرَى عَنْ عُيَيْنَةٍ لِيَقُولُ أَهَؤُلَاءِ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ بَيْنِنَا أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَعْلَمَ بِالشَّاكِرِينَ وَإِذَا جَاءَكَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِآيَاتِنَا فَقُلْ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ الرَّحْمَةَ قال فرمى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الصحيفة. And the messenger of Allah, when the ayah came down, he threw away that صحيفة which he was about to write for الأقرع, or he was about to have written for الأقرع عن عيينة. ثم دعانا, and so then he called them both. فأتيناه فقال سلام عليكم كتب ربكم على نفسه الرحمة فدنونا منه حتى وضعنا ركبانا على ركبته وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يجلس معنا فإذا أراد أن يقوم قام وتركنا فأنزل الله واصبر نفسك مع الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه ولا تعد عيناك عنهم تريد زينة الحياة الدنيا أي يقول لا تعد عيناك عنهم وتجالس الأشراف. And so here we see again the ayah in which the messenger of Allah, he's been told to not turn away from the poor and go and sit with the noble ones. وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغَفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا, referring to عُيَيْنَا هَنَلْقَى بْنْ حَابِسِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا ثُمَّ ضَرَبَ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا رَجُلَيْنِ وَمَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Of course, these ayat come underneath it. وَضَرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا رَجُلَيْنِ, and then وَضَرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَا نَزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا. طيب, فقال كنا نقعد مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فإذا بلغنا الساعة التي يقوم قمنا وتركناه حتى يقوم. قال محمد بن حسين أحق الناس باستعمال هذا بعد رسول الله أهل القرآن إذا جلسوا لتعليم القرآن يريدون به الله. And so here the last part that Muhammad ibn Hussein al-Ajuri رحمه الله takes the benefit from its author from is that the messenger of Allah used to sit with the people, whether it be rich or poor, and when it was the time in which they were finished, then they would stand, and he would then stand. طيب وتركناه حتى يقوم. طيب, and so you don't finish. Let them finish, and when they finish and they depart, you then depart. That's the etiquette of the teacher. نعم, as I mentioned, هذا أثر ضعيف لا يثبت. طيب, قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا فيليابي قال حدثنا عديد بن خالد بن موهب الرملي قال حدثنا عيسى بن يونس عن هارون بن أبي وكيع عن هارون بن أبي وكيع قال سمعت زادان أبا عمر يقول دخلت على ابن مسعود فوجدت أصحاب الخز واليمنة قد سبقوني إلى المجلس فناديته يا عبد الله من أجل أني رجل أعمى أدنيت هؤلاء وأقصيتني فقال ادنه قد دنوت حتى كان بيني وبينه جليس قال محمد بن الحسين وأحب له إذا جاء من يريد أن يقرأ عليه من صغير أو حدث أو كبير أن يعتبر كل واحد منهم قبل أن يلقنه من سورة البقرة يعتبره بأن يعرف ما معه من الحمد إلى مقدار ربع سبع أو أكثر مما يؤدي به صلاته ويصلح أن يؤم به في الصلوات إذا احتاج إليه. طيب, and so the previous author is essentially reinforcing what we mentioned previously, in that the poor ones and the ones who are yani in need, they should be brought closer. So when the blind man came to Ibn Mas'ud and said, why have you yani brought these people in front of me, the people who yani are shopkeepers in terms of people who sell wool and clothes and so on, and people who have been given ease in this world, when the blind man came, said, why you have them in ahead of me and I'm at the back? And so Ibn Mas'ud said, come closer, and he came as close as you could possibly get, in that there was just one person sitting between him and Ibn Mas'ud. Now, as for the statement of Al-Ajuri, which follows from that, he's talking about yani how you should teach the student. طيب. And so when a student comes to you, whether it be a young one or just the one who's reached past puberty, or he's an older person, that you should test them, see what they know with the Quran. First of all, with the Fatiha. So you begin with the Fatiha. حتى as the author rahimahullah mentioned, بأن يعرف ما معه من الحمد. Right, الحمد different to the Fatiha. And so you have to see how good are they with the Fatiha. And then after the Fatiha, what else do they know? So what is this person's level? You have to gauge that. طيب, you don't just start letting him read from Baqarah or letting him read from wherever he wants. You have to test him, you have to see what his level is, right? And then you look at what is most beneficial for him. What is most beneficial for him is to know enough of the Quran so that he can be able to perform the Salah. طيب, especially if he's asked to lead the prayer, he's got enough information, he's got enough of the Quran that he can lead the people in prayer with. طيب, that's how you begin. And you begin by perfecting that. طيب, and then the author rahimahullah, he says, فَإِنْ كَانَ يُحْسِنُهُ, and when he perfects that, وَكَانَ تَعْلُمُهُ فِي الْكِتَابِ أَصْلَحَ مِنْ لِسَانِهِ وَقَوَّمَهُ. So now when the individual has got enough of the Quran so that he's able to pray the Salah correctly, so he knows the Fatiha, he knows the short surahs, or he knows enough of the Quran so he's able to pray the Salah, you then go on to the next step, which is to allow him to be able to start reading from the Mus'haf, right? And you correct him. You correct his pronunciation and the way that he's reciting the Quran from the Mus'haf. So it's not straight away from the Hifz, as the author rahimahullah mentioned, وَكَانَ تَعَلُّمُهُ فِي الْكِتَابِ أَصْلَحَ مِنْ لِسَانِهِ وَقَوَّمَهُ. So you look at the person, how he's able to read the Quran, how he's able to read the Quran. So there are many methods. Some in our country back home, they use the lawh, so you write the Quran. Others, they use the Mus'haf, so you read the Quran, right? And you read it the way that your teacher reads it to you. And so you sit there, you teach him how to read the Quran, and you correct the mistakes that he makes. طيب, then the author رحمه الله تعالى, he says, حتى يصلح أن يؤدي به فرائضه ثم يبتدئ فيلقنه من سورة البقرة وأحب لمن يلقن إذا قرئ عليه أن يحسن الاستماع إلى من يقرأ عليه. طيب, so here the author, he says, once that is done, so now you've gone past that stage where the student is able to what? He's able to know how to read the Quran, he knows sufficiently how to read the Quran, right, in terms of the wordings, in terms of the pronunciation of the letters, right, and he's able to know enough of the Quran so he's able to pray the Salah correctly and have a valid prayer, so he knows the Fatiha, he knows some short surahs. طيب, now you begin to make him read the Quran and teach him the Quran, and generally you begin from Surah Al-Baqarah and you work your way down, although some like to begin from Surah Al-Nas and work their way up. Both are equally valid, there's no harm in either one. طيب, and so you take it step by step inshallah ta'ala. And there are some yani special forms, special techniques that are used by teachers to teach their students the the Quran, special methods that they use, that they've attained through tajriba, through experimentation, right? And they now see the benefits of such methods, and maybe one day we can go through and share our own special methods and techniques in the recitation of the Quran al-Kareem, and how to get a student to become competent in the recitation of the Quran al-Kareem. قال المصنف رحمه الله ولا يشت وأحب لمن يلقن إذا قرئ عليه أن يحسن الاستماع إلى من يقرأ عليه. And so it's important that when you are learning the Quran and someone is teaching you the Quran, that you listen to them. And that's something that many students fall foul of. They don't listen to the teacher, and so they fall into a mistake. When the teacher is actually listen to what the teacher was reciting, you wouldn't fall into that mistake, because generally when the teacher recites, he's emphasizing these special parts, where he's reciting it in a way to make it stick into your mind, so that when you start reading it, you don't fall into that mistake, rather you recall how your teacher recited it. But if you're not listening to the teacher, then that's going to be difficult for you to avoid those little pitfalls and those little mistakes. ولا يشتغل عنه بحديث ولا غيره. Likewise, you shouldn't be occupying yourself with what? With talking to others or anything else. Rather, the focus should be on what your teacher is saying. And so when your teacher is reciting, you shouldn't be on your phone, you shouldn't be fidgeting or anything like that. You should be focused on what the teacher is reciting, right? It's not a break for you. Just because the teacher is reciting doesn't mean that you can switch off. That's the most important part of the lesson, actually, to listen to how the teacher is reciting. فبالحري أن ينتفع به من يقرأ عليه. طيب. And so it's imperative for you to benefit from the teacher who is reciting upon you. نعم. When he's teaching you how to recite the Quran al-Kareem. وكذلك ينتفع هو أيضا. Likewise, the teacher, he also, when the student is reciting, don't switch off, because this is an opportunity for you to listen and to contemplate. Remember, you're going to hear the Quran daily, you're going to hear the Quran. And so it's a new opportunity for you to contemplate over the Quran al-Kareem. To contemplate over the ma'ani of the Quran al-Kareem. Oh, this ayah, I've heard it now, and it's made me think about X, made me think about Y. Remember, لا تنقضي عجائبه. لا تنقضي عجائب القرآن. The wisdoms of the Quran are infinite. However many times you read it, every time you read it, a verse, there's a new benefit that comes out. طيب. Of course, this is as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, في ذلك لذكرى لمن كان له قلب أو ألقى السمع وهو شهيد. نعم. So the author, he mentioned, ويتدبر ويسمع أو يتدبر ما يسمع من غيره وربما كان سماعه للقرآن من غيره له فيه زيادة منفعة وأجر عظيم. Right? So listening to the Quran from other than you, it can be sometimes better for you than you just reading it. When you're reading it, you have to focus on you reading along with the meaning, and so you can miss out on some things. But when you're listening to someone else recite the Quran, it makes it can be even more beneficial for you. You can think about more things, and it can open a lot more doors for you in terms of tadabbur over the Quran al-Kareem. نعم. ويتناول قول الله تعالى وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وانصتوا. And because when you hear the Quran being recited and someone's reading the Quran upon you, it allows you to act upon this ayah, that you're hearing the Quran being recited, and so listen to it with attentiveness. نعم. So that you may gain what? The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so one of the routes of gaining the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that when the Quran is recited, you hear it and you listen to it with giving it your entire attention. نعم. Then the author رحمه الله, he says, فَإِذَا لَمْ يَتَحَدَّثْ مَعَ غَيْلِهِ وَأَنصَتَ إِلَيْهِ أَدْرَكَتْهُ الرَّحْمَةُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. So as I mentioned, that when you don't talk to others and you completely focus on the recitation that's being recited upon you, it allows you to enter into or to be from amongst those who are going to attain the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَانَ أَنْفَعَ لِلْقَارِئِ عَلَيْهِ. Likewise, more beneficial to the qari', because you're more attentive, you're going to pick out the mistakes. You're more likely to pick out the mistakes that the qari' falls into, that the reciter falls into, and so that the reciter can then correct it. Now, فقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لعبد الله بن مسعود اقرا علي. And so the messenger of Allah used to do this, and so of course we're following the sunnah here. The messenger of Allah used to say to Abdullah bin Mas'ud, اقرا علي, read upon me. And so the messenger of Allah, Ibn Mas'ud would reply, يا رسول الله اقرا عليك وعليك انزل, how can I recite upon you when the Quran was revealed upon you? And so the messenger of Allah, he said عليه الصلاة والسلام, اني احب ان اسمعه من غيري. Indeed, I love for the Quran to be for me to hear the Quran from other than me. And so he would then recite Ibn Mas'ud until he reached قول الله تعالى فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا. And so then the messenger of Allah said حسبك حسبك. And so when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud put up his head and looked towards the face of the messenger of Allah, فإذا عيناه تذرفان, and the messenger of Allah, his eyes were welled up with tears عليه الصلاة والسلام. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله: أخبرنا الفريابي قال: حدثنا محمد بن الحسين البلخي قال لنا عبد الله بن مبارك قال لنا سفيان أي الثوري عن سليمان أي الأعمش عن إبراهيم أي النخعي عن عبيدة السلمان يعني بن مسعود ذي زغوت إمام زي مبارك زين إمام سفيان زين إمام الأعمش زين إمام إبراهيم زين إمام عبيدة أو عبيدة زين إمام likewise of course بن مسعود is also an imam. قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: اقرأ علي. فقلت: أقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل. فقال: إني أحب أن أسمعه من غيري. قال: فافتتحت سورة النساء فلما بلغته: فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا؟ قال: فرأيت عينيه تذرفان. فقال لي: حسبك. وأحب لمن كان يكره أن لا يدرس عليه وقت الدرس إلا واحد. And so now this is كلام محمد بن حسين الأجري. And of course the حديث that we just recited is في الصحيحين، وهو حديث مشهور معروف. نعم. I'll be mentioned just a few minutes ago in an explanation. طيب. Then the author رحمه الله he says وأحب لمن كان يقرأ أن لا يدرس عليه وقت الدرس إلا واحد. And so one of the things that الأجري wants and loves for the teacher is that he has one student at a time. Dedicate your attention to one student at any given one time. Of course, يعني today we have madaris and so we have many students, but you don't have them all reading to you at once. طيب. Some people do that, some people like that. So the teacher has يعني he has 10 people reading to him at once, and that's not something which is advisable, because يعني your attention span is going to be what? Divided, one tenth on this one, you might not be able to be focused on all of them. طيب. And so one person at a time, and so you're able to completely focus yourself upon that one person and correcting his mistakes. نعم. ولا يكون ثانيا معه فهو أنفع للجميع. And so this is beneficial to everyone, both student and teacher. The teacher is not disturbed, right? He doesn't have to divide his attention between multiple students. Rather, he can focus on one at any given one time. طيب. وأما التلقين. What is التلقين? التلقين is for you to recite and the teacher, as the teacher and the students to pick up on your recitation and repeat after you. And so you're actually giving the Quran to your student in terms of lafzan. So you are saying, مثلا, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. And then the student says, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. And then you say, Alhamdulillahi ila akhirihi. طيب. And then he says, Alhamdulillahi. طيب. And then you say, Ar-Rahmani. And then so on. طيب. تلقينه القرآن. And every time he makes a mistake, you stop him and you correct him. طيب. This is what at-talqeen. Now. And so the author, he says, فَلَا بَأْسَ أَنْ يُلَقِّنَ الْجَمَاعَةِ. So when it comes to تلقين, meaning you recite and they follow you, it doesn't matter if the people that are following you are a group. And so مثلا you say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. And then the students of the group say what? بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. And then you continue like that. هَذَا لَا بَأْسَ بِهِ. But in terms of التسميع, meaning when they come and recite the Quran upon you, it should be what? Individual. نعم. Then the author, رحمه الله, he says, وَيَنْبَغِي لِمَنْ قَرَأَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنَ فأخطأ عليه أو غلط أن لا يعنفه وأن يرفق به ولا يجفو عليه ويصبر عليه فإني لا آمن أن يجفو عليه فينفر عنه. And so when you're reciting the, or when you're teaching the Quran and those whom are your students, they are reciting upon you and they make a mistake. وهذا يعني something which is definitely going to happen. The student is going to make a mistake. He's going to err. You shouldn't be extremely harsh upon them, right? You shouldn't be severe upon them, right? You shouldn't be excessive upon them. Why? Because this excessiveness, this harshness, might lead them to not come want to come back. If you beat them, if you يعني, abuse them يعني, in a way that does not please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? You're going to lose a student. He's going to feel like, why should I come here, right? I'm going to get my behind beat, right? I'm going to get licks and then go home and come back and get licks and then go home and come back and get licks. What's the point? I just want to quit. طيب, many students feel like that because of the bad treatment that they have received from the teacher. طيب, and this is something which is bad because you're blocking the student from the Quran and you're giving this person a negative experience with the Quran al-Kareem. طيب, and especially a child in his formative years being يعني being scarred by that, it will affect him in later life and you're going to have to carry that wisdom on their judgment. نعم, so you have to avoid that. طيب, وبالحري أن لا يعود إلى المسجد. وقد روي عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال علموا ولا تعنفوا فإن المعلم خير من المعنف. هذا حديث ضعيف. طيب, however, the معنى is correct. طيب, in that don't be extremely harsh with the student. طيب, build a rapport with the student such that when the time requires for harshness, he understands. طيب, when you build a positive relationship with the student, طيب, eventually there's going to come a time which the student is going to have to be treated with harshness, but he understands that the harshness is for his own benefit. But if you're just beating everybody left, right, and center, no care, he doesn't know you, you don't know him, he's just a new student, and you're whacking him across the face, you're beating him for no reason, right? He makes a little mistake here and you make it something so big, and you don't have a good relationship with the student, he's not going to think that this, the harshness that you're giving him is of benefit to him. Rather, he's going to see it as a hindrance to his development. Now, وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن بعثتم ميسرين ولم تبعثوا معسرين. We've been brought to be easygoing, not to make things difficult. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله وحدثنا حامد بن شعيب البلخي قال حدثنا بشير بن الوليد وحدثنا عمر بن أيوب السقطي قال حدثنا الحسن بن عرفة قال حدثنا إسماعيل بن عياش عن حميد بن أبي سويد عن طائف بن رباح عن أبي هريرة عن أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال علموا ولا تعنفوا فإن المعلم خير من المعنف. هذا ما حديث ضعيف بل منكر, حديث ضعيف بل منكر, نعم, وحديث ضعيف جدا. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو القاسم عبد الله بن محمد بن عبد العزيز قال حدثنا علي بن الجعد, of course أبو القاسم عبد الله بن محمد بن عبد العزيز البغوي, قال حدثنا علي بن الجعد شيخ البخاري قال حدثنا شعبة عن أبي التياه قال سمعت أنس بن مالك يحدث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال يسروا ولا تعسروا وسكنوا ولا تنفروا. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله أخبرنا أبو عبد الله أحمد بن الحسين بن عبد الجبار الصوفي قال حدثنا محمد بن بكار قال حدثنا عنبسة بن عبد الواحد عن عمرو بن عامر البجلي قال قال عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه تعلموا العلم وتعلموا للعلم السكينة والحلمة. So he's saying he learned knowledge, and also when you're learning knowledge, right, in order to learn it, learn also how to be serene and how to have forbearance. So a person with ilm but no forbearance is not going to be able to spread that ilm, right? So you learn ilm and now you want to spread that ilm. In order to be able to spread it, you have to have peace. You have to be serene. You have to be comfortable. You have to be confident. You have to be calm, collected. And you have to be forbearing. نعم. فَتَوَاضَعَ لِمَنْ تُعَلِّمُونَ وَلِيَتَوَاضَعَ لَكُمْ مَنْ تُعَلِّمُونَ. So show humility to those whom you are teaching, and let those whom you are teaching show humility to you as well. ولا تكونوا جبابرة العلماء فلا يقوم علمكم بجهلكم. قال محمد بن الحسين فمن كانت هذه أخلاقه انتفع به من يقرأ عليه. نعم. And so here, the last part of the Athar of Umar رضي الله عنه is that don't be the, when you are a scholar, don't be a arrogant scholar. Don't be, don't treat yourself as being a king. طيب, when you are a scholar, when you are an alim. طيب, لا تكونوا جبابرة العلماء فلا يقوم علمكم بجهلكم. Why? Because if you are like this, then your ilm will not be of benefit to other people, will not be upright, will not be standing because of your ignorance. You've ruined your ilm with your ignorance, right? Because to be a jabbar, to be someone who is arrogant and self-amazed and thinks of himself in such a haughty way and in a high and mighty manner, طيب, this is a jahl within you, this is ignorance within you. طيب, and it's that ignorance which prevents your ilm from actually coming out and being of benefit to the rest of the ummah. Now, قال أجري رحمه الله فمن كانت هذه أخلاقه. And so the one who has these etiquettes, of course, that we mentioned from how you should teach your student, right, انتفع به, you will benefit from it first and foremost as a teacher, and you're likewise, those whom you are students, those whom are your students will also benefit from it as well, having these good etiquettes when you are a teacher, these etiquettes we have mentioned throughout this lesson. نعم. ثم أقول, then I say, إنه ينبغي لمن كان يقرأ القرآن لله أن يصون نفسه عن استقضاء الحوائج ممن يقرأ عليه القرآن وأن لا يستخدمه ولا يكلفه حاجة يقوم بها, وأختار له إذا عرضت له حاجة أن يكلفها لمن لا يقرأ عليه, وأحب أن يصون القرآن على أن يقضى له بالحوائج. And so this is the point we mentioned in previous lessons, in that you shouldn't use the Quran as a بضاعة, as a trading item. Right, in order to have things done for you. I'm a half of the Quran, I'm a teacher, do this for me. I'm a teacher, do this for me. I'm your teacher, do this for me. In terms of what? حوائج الدنيا. Right, you don't want to use the Quran to fulfill your dunyawi aspirations. Now, that's what the author rahimahullah is trying to hint at in these statements. طيب, then the author rahimahullah, and we spoke about this in previous lessons. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فَإِنْ عُرِضَتْ لَهُ حَاجَةٌ سَأَلَ مَوْلَاهُ الْكَرِيمَ قَضَاءَهَا. And so when the haja and the need comes to you, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to to fulfill it for you. Right? كُلْ مُتَوَكِّلًا عَلَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَا عَلَى الْعِبَادِ. نعم. فإذا ابتدأه أحد من إخوانه من غير مسألة منه فقضاها شكر الله. However, if someone comes and does something for you without you asking for it, and that's something which happens to the Qurra and the people of Quran, that people do things for them and they never ask for it. But if that does happen, أشكر الله. Thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى for that ni'mah. إضصاله عن المسألة. Because Allah سبحانه وتعالى protected you from having to ask. طيب. You were patient, you didn't ask anybody, and suddenly someone came and gave you. طيب. Because you are from the Qurra and the Huffaz, and those who are من حملة كتاب الله. Right? This is the ni'mah that you should ask, that you should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. Because He protected you from using the Quran to what? To seek help from others. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought you your faraj. Naam. And there are many stories of Qurra and Huffaz who were practicing this etiquette of not asking anybody for anything. طيب. And a lot of barakat came to them without them even asking for it. Naam. وقال المصنف رحمه الله وإذ سهل الله له قضاء. So نعم. فإذا ابتدأه أحد من إخوانه من غير مسألة منه فقضاها شكر الله. إذا إصانه عن المسألة وتذلل لأهل الدنيا وإذ سهل الله له قضاءها ثم يشكر من أجرى ذلك على يديه. So after thanking Allah, thank the one who brought you this good and the one that helped you. طيب. Without you having asked for it. نعم. فإن هذا واجب عليه. Of course, من لا يشكر الناس لا يشكر الله كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإن هذا واجب عليه وقد رويته فيما ذكرت أخبارا تدل على ما قلت وأنا أذكرها ليزداد الناظر في كتابنا بصيرة إن شاء الله. So he's going to bring us some آثار that strengthen the point that he has just made. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو الفضل العباسي بيوسف الشكلي قال حدثنا إسحاق بن الجراح الأذني قال حدثنا ابن الربيع البوراني قال كنت عند عبد الله بن إدريس فلما قمت قال لي سل عن سعر الأشناني فلما مشيت ردني فقال لا تسأل فإنك تكتب مني الحديث وأنا أكره أن أسأل من يسمع مني الحديث حاجة. نعم. الأشنان is a Persian word. It's a Persian word that has been Arabized. It's an Arabized word from Persia, right? And what it actually means is the item of washing that is used to wash clothes. And so there's a specific type of item, right? That they would use, a specific type of يعني, detergent, you could say, that they would use to wash the clothes with. طيب. And so here, this Abdullah ibn Idris, right, or Ibn Rabi' al-Burani was with Abdullah ibn Idris, and so when he stood up, so when Ibn Rabi' al-Burani stood up to leave the majlis, Abdullah ibn Idris said to him, "Sell an si'rin ushnan." Go and ask about the price tag or the cost of this ushnan. And so when I went to go, so now Ibn Rabi' is going to go and ask around for the price of the ushnan. Raddani, he told me to come back, and he said to me, "La tas'al, don't ask the people. فإنك تكتب مني الحديث." Indeed, you write for me hadith. وأنا أكره أن أسأل من يسمع مني الحديث حاجة. Indeed, I dislike to ask someone who learns hadith from me from something. And this is the point that I already made, that you shouldn't use the Quran or the hadith to gain or benefits or to ask something from your students. طيب. And so this is backing up the point that Al-Ajuri رحمه الله تعالى made. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو الفضل قال حدثنا إسحاق بن جراح قال خلف بن تميم مات أبي وعليه دين فأتيت حمزة الزيات فيمس قارئ القراءة في حمزة. نعم. فسألته أن يكلم صاحب الدين أن يضع عن أبي من دينه شيئا فقال لي حمزة ويحك إنه يقرأ علي القرآن وأنا أكره أن أشرب من بيتي من يقرأ علي القرآن الماء. أن سو حمزة بن حبيب الزيات رحمة الله عليه, he was asked by somebody whose father had died and he had owed some debt. And so the son came and asked Hamza, go and ask the one who my dad owes debt to lower the debt and to forgive the debt, right? And so Hamza said, "Wayhak, woe be upon you. This person who your father owed money is my student. I teach him Quran. And I indeed hate for me to drink water from the house of a person who has recited Quran upon me." Again, showing the level of sincerity that is great imams had, and again reaffirming the point that al-imam al-ajuri rahimahullah made earlier. قال المصنف رحمه الله: حدثنا جعفر بن أحمد الصندلي قال حدثنا فضل بن زياد قال حدثنا عبد الصمد بن يزيد قال سمعت الفضيل بن عياض يقول: ينبغي لحامل القرآن أن لا يكون له حاجة إلى أحد من الناس، إلى خليفة فمن دونه، وينبغي أن تكون حوائج الخلق إليه. وسؤال أثر كما حسب فوق. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله: حدثنا حامد بن شعيب البلخي قال حدثنا شريح بن يونس قال حدثنا إسحاق بن سليمان الرازي وأبو النضر عن أبي جعفر الرازي عن الربيع بن أنس قال: مكتوب في التوراة: علم مجانا كما علمت مجانا. And so here it has come in the Torah: teach for free, just as you have been taught for free. Who taught us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ويعلمكم الله. Allah taught us for free. والله خلقكم أو الله أخرجكم من بطون أمهاتكم لا تعلمون شيئا وجعل لكم السمع والأبصار والأفئدة لعلكم تشكرون. Allah is the one who taught us. And we never gave up anything. We didn't pay Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ilm that he gave us. Right? لا. And so just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the ilm for free, also teach for free as well. And this is a parable from the Yahud. نعم. Or from the previous revelation that was sent down upon the Yahud. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله: أخبرنا أبو عبد الله أحمد بن الحسن بن عبد الجبار الصوفي قال حدثنا شجاع بن مخلد قال حدثنا إسماعيل بن إبراهيم عن هشام الدستوائي عن يحيى بن أبي كثير عن راشد بن الحراني قال: قال عبد الرحمن بن شبل قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: اقرأوا القرآن ولا تغلوا فيه ولا تجفوا عنه ولا تأكلوا به ولا تستكثروا. This hadith is incredibly important. And many benefits can be extracted from it. Much of it we have already taken previously. In that, number one, اقرأ القرآن, recite the Quran. However, don't go extreme with it. يعني, we are what? هدات. بين الغلات والجفات. That's the منهج. Right? منهج الهدات بين الغلات والجفات. We are not غلات, we are not جفات. طيب. فلا تغلو فيه ولا تجفو عنه. Likewise, ولا تأكلوا به. Do not consume with it. Meaning, do not use the Quran as a بضاعة, as a trading item. That you want to trade with in order to gain or to, in order to fulfill your aspirations in this dunya. ولا تستكثروا ولا تستكثروا. نعم. Do not use it to increase your wealth. Meaning people who use the Quran to what? To increase their wealth, to increase their status in this dunya. لا, we don't want that. طيب, rather we learn the Quran for what? لله سبحانه وتعالى. نعم. And this hadith, whilst the benefits that can be extracted from it we've spoken about it throughout this series. طيب, this special wording or this specific wording is not found in any of the books of hadith. طيب, no. قال المصنف رحمه الله: حدثنا أبو العباس أحمد بن سهل الأشناني أو الأشناني قال حدثنا بشر بن الوليد قال لنا فليح بن سليمان عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن بن معمر عن سعيد بن يسار عن أبي هريرة قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من تعلم علما مما يبتغى به وجه الله لا يتعلمه إلا ليصيب به عارضا من الدنيا لم يجد غرفات الجنة يوم القيامة. So this is a dangerous hadith. Those who learn a science or an علم in which we are supposed to seek by it وجه الله سبحانه وتعالى, and you only learn it to get some form of dunyawi reward, then you will not taste or you will not be able to find the rooms of paradise. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned لهم غرف من فوقها غرف مبنية تجري من تحت الأنهار وعد الله لا يخلف الله الميعاد. And so you're not going to be able to see that in Jannah. Because why? You learned العلم for the sake of other than Allah. You learned العلم in order to benefit from this dunya, in order to gain some form of يعني wealth or status or nobility in this dunya, right? And as we know, the first three people who will be dragged with their faces into the fire, one of them is what? The one who learnt al-ilm, right? But he only learned it so that he can be called an adim, right? And this again is an important reminder to check our sincerity and why we are doing the things that we are doing. Now, قال المصنف رحمه الله: أخبرنا أبو عبد الله محمد بن مخلد قال حدثنا محمد بن إسماعيل الحساني قال حدثنا وكيع عن واقد مولى زيد بن خليدة عن زادان قال: من قرأ القرآن يتأكل به الناس جاء يوم القيامة وجهه عظم ليس عليه لحم. هذا الحديث لا أصل له, it has no basis. طيب, And what it's saying is that the one who recites the Quran and he wants to use the Quran in order to eat from that which the people have, then he will come on the day of judgment and his face will be what? Bones without any flesh. Naam. وهذا حديث لا أصل له. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا أبو محمد يحيى بن محمد بن صاعد قال حدثنا شعيب بن أيوب قال حدثنا عبد الله بن نمير قال حدثنا معاوية النصري عن نهشل عن الضحاك عن الأسود بن يزيد وقال غير شعيب وعلقمة ولم أرى شعيبا ذكر علقمة قال قال عبد الله يعني بن مسعود of course علقمة هي علقمة بن قيس. نعم. لأن أهل العلم صانوا العلم ووضعوه عند أهله سادوا به أهل زمانهم ولكنهم بذلوه لأهل الدنيا لينالوا من دنياهم فهانوا على أهلها سمعت نبيكم صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من جعل الهم هما واحدا هم آخرته كفاه الله هم دنياه ومن تشعبت به الهموم في أحوال دنيا لم يبار الله في أي أوديتها هلك. نعم. طيب. يعني you can see the statement of Ibn Mas'ud is incredibly poignant, incredibly powerful, right? That if the people of knowledge protected knowledge and they gave it to its people, then they would يعني become the leaders of their people. And so it's important that the teacher and the student have this relationship in that the teacher knows the potential or sees the potential in the student to be a vessel that can carry this ilm, right? And so you're not, this is a prized treasure. The ilm is a prized treasure. And so you can't just give it to anybody. And if you really want the generation that comes after you to be great, you have to give the ilm to those who are deserving of it, to those who really deserve it. Now, however, the people, what happened was they gave it to the people of the dunya, people who had no care for it, and people who did not give or did not treat this ilm with the way that it should be treated. And so the people saw knowledge as being something which is what? Not sacred. Not something which is worthy of or of taking, and it became something which was light and not heavy. Now, and then the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, من جعل الهم هما واحدا هم آخرته كفاه الله هم دنيا. When the person makes his hem, i.e. what he deems to be the most important, that which I'm going to put everything in, all of my efforts go into that, and that is my akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of the humum that a person goes through in this world. However, when the person has multiple avenues and he's yani his energy is being put into multiple things, right? Especially when it comes to the dunya, so he's instead of focusing on the hereafter, he's focusing all his attention on the dunya, all of his efforts are going into the dunya, right? And there are multiple streams that he's trying to use in order to get something in this dunya, whether it be wealth or status or nobility. He's trying to use multiple different pathways to get to the goal, which is yani honor or status or nobility or wealth in this dunya. This person yani لم يباري الله أو لم يباري الله في أي أودياتها هلك. This person will eventually reach a stage in which he will not be able to care about whatever lane that he's taken to gain that dunya, whatever lane he will use himself to be, or he will become destroyed in. نعم he will die in. طيب and يعني this hadith of the messenger of Allah is munkar. This hadith is munkar. نعم. قال المصنف رحمه الله so the author of Mas'ud is okay but the hadith that is mentioned is munkar. نعم. حدثنا أبو عبد الله محمد بن مخلد قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن مهدي قال حدثنا أحمد بن عبد الله فيروز قال حدثنا العباس بن بكار الضبي قال حدثنا عيسى بن عمر النحوي قال أقبلت حتى أقمت عند الحسن البصري فسمعته يقول قرأ هذا القرآن ثلاثة رجال فرجل قرأه فاتخذه بضاعة ونقله من بلد لا بلد ورجل قرأه فأقام على حروف وضيع حدوده يقول إني والله لا أسكت من القرآن حرفا كثر الله بهم القبور وأخلى منهم الدور فوالله لهم أشد كبرا من صاحب السرير على سريره ومن صاحب المنبر على منبره ورجل قرأه فأسهر ليله وأظمأ نهاره ومنع شهوته فجثوا في براثينهم وركضوا في محاربهم بهم ينفي الله عنا العدو وبهم يسقين الله الغيث وهذا الضرب من القراء أعز من الكبريت الأحمر. And so this is an author which was taken previously, طيب, in a summarized form. And now Al-Ajuri brought it in its complete form, right? Those three individuals, the mu'min, the fajr, and the munafiq. Now, we spoke about it in previous lessons. Now, and so look how important the qari is, the one who learned it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the one whom we can use to protect ourselves from the from the adu. Bihim yanfillahu anna al-adu. It is because of these people being amongst us that Allah protects us from the enemy. And it's because of people like this present amongst us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows the rain to descend upon us. Now, قال الأجري رحمه الله الأخبار في هذا المعنى كثيرة ومرادي من هذا نصيحة لأهل القرآن. Again, here you see the recurring theme. The reason why he's bringing this athar is as a nasiha, as an advice that is given to أهل القرآن. لألا يبطل سعيهم إنهم طلبوا به شرف الدنيا حرموا شرف الآخرة. And so the reason why he's giving this nasiha is that you أهل القرآن أو أهل القرآن, don't let your work go to waste. Don't let your work go to waste. Do not seek the dunya with the Quran that you have. Rather seek the akhirah. Because the one who seeks this world, who seeks to use in the Quran this world, he will not be given the sharaf, the honor of the hereafter. إِذْ يَتُونَهُ لِأَهْلِ الدُّنْيَا طَمَعًا فِي دُنْيَاهُمْ أَعَاذَ اللَّهُ حَمَلَةَ الْقُرْآنِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the carriers of the Quran from being from amongst those who recite for the people of the dunya, seeking their dunya. فَيَنْبَغِي لِمَنْ يَجْلِسُ يقر المسلمين أن يتأدب بأدب القرآن يقتضي ثوابه من الله يستغني بالقرآن عن كل أحد من الخلق متواضع في نفسه ليكون رضيعا عند الله. And so the person who is teaching the people the Quran, he should be humble in himself in order for him to be raised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. من تواضع لله رفعه الله. And so he should seek the Quran as his means to self-sufficiency in terms of, يعني, the Quran is enough for us. The Quran is sufficient for us. حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل, of course. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Quran for us to what to contemplate over. وننجو من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين. يهدي به الله من اتبع رضوانه سبل السلام قد جاءكم من الله نور وكتاب مبين. And so there are many benefits to the Quran. And so making the Quran sufficient and enough for us, that is the goal of the one who is teaching the Quran al-Kareem. And likewise, التأدو بأداب القرآن, that we conduct ourselves with the etiquettes that are enjoined in the Quran al-Kareem. قال المصنف رحمه الله حدثنا علي بن إسحاق بن زاطية قال حدثنا عبد الله بن عمرو القواريري قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد قال سمعت أيوب السختياني يقول ينبغي للعالم يضع الرماد على رأسه تواضعا لله. And so it's imperative for a scholar to remove the dust from his head in order for what? To show humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. من تواضع لله رفعه الله. And with that, the author رحمه الله concludes his chapter. And so we'll stop here بإذن الله. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.